Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to NUPI. My name is Julius Sverdrup. I'm the director here. It's my great pleasure to welcome you all to NUPI this afternoon. Normally, we have seminars earlier in the day, so it's great to see that we have such a huge turnout in the afternoon as well. And hopefully, people are not stuck in the building or the elevator somewhere, because sometimes the front door closes at, I think, in 5 minutes' time. But just be relaxed. We will let you out. and you will be able to leave. We plan to finish around 10 past 5. Because then Nathalie has to catch a plane, I think. Okay. I only hinted briefly to it. I think we're really happy today to have Nathalie Tocci joining us. She's a prominent researcher on Europe's relationship to the rest of the world. She's a deputy director of our Italian sister institute, Istituto Affari Internazionali in Rome. But she's more importantly these days, I guess, she's a key figure in developing EU's global strategy. Working very closely with Mogherini in doing this, and they have a short time span. The work is supposed to finish and to be presented to the heads of state in the summit at the summit this summer. Now, the background, I believe, as some of you are aware of, that the EU prepared a global strategy more than 10 years ago, so in 2003. That's the first and so far the only global strategy. It doesn't mean that the EU never had a global strategy in between, but never a proper document, comprehensive document. And right now, we have lots of difficult challenges facing the European Union. And if you take the full geographic circle in the south, we have all the difficulties with the imploding state system, instabilities. Turkey, I guess, is a major concern or major issue. We have in the east, we have difficulties in relationship with Russia. In the north, people in Norway is concerned about that. So we have the Arctic and the developments in the Arctic. And also in the West, there are issues on the transatlantic dimension. So the full 360 degree. In addition to that, you have the global level, the changing nature of the global or the world order, the political order, the future of multilateral institutions, etc. And in addition to that, to top it off, the domestic disputes and arguments going on the future of what should be the competences, allocation of competences, and the future of European cooperation. Now, so we look forward to Nathalie to share your views on the status of this process now and what we should prepare ourselves for. In addition to that, another topic, another backdrop for this meeting this afternoon is that the Norwegian government has announced that they're preparing a white paper on its foreign policy strategy. It's called Veivalg in Norwegian, but I don't know the proper English translation. It's not a fork in the road or crossroads. I think that sounds a bit more dramatic, but some kind of challenges ahead. And NUPI has been invited to host some seminars to contribute to that process. And so this is the second out of six such seminars. We hosted one on fragile states, and we've also been engaged in the European Global Strategy earlier on a seminar on energy security. Now, there are many similarities between the challenges facing Norway and the challenges facing Europe. But there's an additional element to it, the fact that the European strategy is likely to be kind of impose some kind of limits or affect the Norwegian strategy. So I think there are some diplomats and some others who are eager to say, well, how can Norway try to influence the wording of the European global strategy in a fashion that makes it more suitable for Norway? Although Norway is not a member of the EU, we're as closely associated as it is possible to be. So one is the European global strategy, it's the challenges and developments, and the other topic for today will be how Norway can respond to it and how the Norwegian interests can be accommodated within that strategy. So we have Nathalie Tocci to give a presentation. She will talk for around 20 minutes. And then Pernille Riker, one of our senior researchers working on Europe, will give a comment on 10 minutes or so on some perspectives on this, also some views from the Norwegian side. And then we have a splendid crowd here today. I'm sure you will be engaging in a discussion. So, and just one minor footnote, this meeting will be streamed. So you're all informed about that. Okay, Nathalie, it's a pleasure to have you here. Floor is yours.
Thanks, it's a real pleasure to be here. It's not the first time I'm here, so it's great to be back. But indeed, I'm here today in a slightly different capacity. So let me start off by making a few remarks on the politics before I get to the policy. And so beginning with the politics, I think the sort of first question one should ask him or herself when engaging in a process such as this is, why are you doing it? Indeed, this was one of the first things that I did when I started this work, when Federica asked me to work on this process, this project, was I phoned up Robert Cooper. Now, Robert Cooper, for those of you who don't know, was the pen holder of the 2003 strategy. So I asked him, phone him up, ask for some advice, and Robert said to me, Nathalie, why are you doing it? So I scratched my head, why are we doing it? And I came up with two answers, one of which was actually similar to 2003, of course, in a different context, and the second one is different. The first one, which is the similar type of political rationale which underpinned the 2003 exercise, is that of forging a common narrative. In 2003, there had been a split over Iraq, and the 2003 European security strategy was really aimed at bridging over that divide. And it was obvious in a number of choices that were made. Just think about effective multilateralism, which was one of the bumper stickers of the 2003 strategy. And it was quite obvious that effective multilateralism tried to bridge over the divide, which on the one hand saw, at the time, France and Germany committed to the multilateralism, and on the other, the effective, that really spoke to a more Anglo-Saxon UK and therefore also US approach to multilateral institutions. So if in a sense, the politics of it really determines then a number of choices that are made. So here too, why are we doing it? We're doing it to create a common narrative. If you think about the European Union these days, you think about Brexit, you think about Grexit, you think about divisions over the refugee crisis, about Russia. We're not in good shape, are we? And therefore, engaging in a process in which we can demonstrate to leaders, to citizens above everything, that actually we can still agree on something and we can agree on something meaningful is in and of itself a result, if you like. The second reason, which is in addition to, if you like, this first political, if you like, finding a unity of purpose, motivation, is really that of finding greater unity in action. And this is where I think this process is different from 2003, which also means that the nature of the document that we're working on is quite different. In 2003, essentially the world for Europeans was not a bad place. We felt that the world was going in our direction. We felt that other countries wanted to look more like us. We could kind of afford not to act. Today, obviously, we're in a very different position. The general sense is that the house is on fire. And so if we were to come up with a strategy which simply limited itself to doing the vision thing, it would probably be considered a failure. So unlike 2003, which in many respects was not really a strategy, meaning it wasn't really a document which pointed not only to the goals, but on the ways to achieve them, this has to be a document which says something about action. It has to address the how question, not just the what question. So this is why it's probably going to be a document of quite a different nature compared to 2003. So this is, if you like, the politics of all of it. And it's also a reason why we're actually calling it a global strategy as opposed to a security strategy, precisely because we want to address the how question. We don't only want to look at security and defense instruments. We want to look at the entire box of tricks, in a sense. This is a whole of EU approach to strategy. And therefore, yes, we're looking at security and defense, but we're also looking at development, at trade, at migration, at energy, at counterterrorism, at cybersecurity. We're looking at all the different instruments and policies and relating those instruments and policies to the selected priorities of the global strategy. So moving on to the strategy itself, what's the starting point of the strategy and how do we go about identifying our priorities? So this is a strategy that starts off by identifying what the EU's interests are in foreign and security policy. And we start with a definition of interest, which is essentially internal, but then has external implications. We essentially outline four basic interests. Firstly, the European Union has an interest in the security of its citizens and its territory. This has an implication, an external implication, which is an interest in peace and stability in surrounding regions. Secondly, the European Union has an interest in the prosperity of its people. And again, this is an internal interest which has an external implication, meaning we have an interest in sustainable development worldwide. And in particular, we have an interest in an open international economic system. That is, in a sense, the prerequisite for our internal prosperity. Thirdly, the European Union has an interest in the resilience of its own democratic systems and the values that underpin its democratic systems. And this is perhaps the one interest which explains why we are talking about interests and we're not following the classic, if you like, EU approach of interests and values, values and interests. Basically, by saying that we have an interest in the resilience of our democracies, it's implicit that we are also talking about values. Now, if we have an interest in the resilience of our democratic systems, this will condition the way in which we act externally. It will condition the way in which, or it should condition the way in which we respond to the refugee crisis, in the way in which we deal with countries that are in the accession process, in the way in which we have to respect international law in anything that we do externally. So again, there's a very close link tying the internal to the external. And then finally, we have an interest in a rules-based global order. And again, this is, in fact, this is the fourth and final interest, which is explicitly external rather than internal with external implications. And here, in a sense, there's a reverse link. If we have an interest in externally in a rules-based global order, the European Union itself has to live up to those rules internally as well. So that's, if you like, the starting point. We then move on to identifying the principles of the global strategy. And here we refer back to the work that was carried out when we published last June, the strategic assessment. The assessment was basically a snapshot of the world as it is and how it is likely to look moving forward. And that is a document that painted a world which is more connected, which is more contested, and which is more complex. And those three C's have implications as far as the global strategy is concerned. Clearly, if the world is more connected, and it's more connected in terms of the movement of people, in terms of the integration of market, in terms of technological progress, etc., it is clear that this has to be a strategy based on engagement. There are no walls, fences, etc., that can keep the world outside. And therefore, we have to proactively engage that world. Now, that may be a point which may sound obvious to many of us here in this room that belong to the so-called foreign policy community. It's not so obvious when you talk to other policy communities. Try to have this conversation with interior ministers, for example. It's not so obvious that that is an answer that they would give to you. But this is an argument, and it's our responsibility for us of the foreign policy community to make that argument, to basically say that retrenchment and closure is simply not an option. Secondly, if the world is more conflictual, more contested, we have to be guided by a strong sense of responsibility. Yes, we have to engage, but we don't have to engage in any old way. We have to engage responsibly. We have to engage in conflicts and crises, doing no harm. We have to engage in conflicts and crises, working, doubling our action on conflict prevention. We have to engage in conflicts by working with others, by partnering more and more effectively with others. We have to engage in conflicts and crises by working on root causes. So responsibility has various meanings to it. And again, yes, engagement, but responsible engagement. Thirdly, if the world is more complex, and it's more complex because power is shifting from the West to the East, power is diffusing beyond the boundaries of the nation state. We have to rethink our partnerships and how we work both internally within the European Union and externally. Internally, an argument that is going to be made is that member states acting alone, acting disjointly, will not be able to achieve anything in world affairs. And externally too, even the European Union, fairly large as it is, will not be able to achieve very much by acting alone or acting disjointly. And therefore, we have to work with our partners, work with like-minded partners like Norway, work with other states, work with international organizations, work with regional organizations, but also think more creatively about the way in which we partner. Partnering with civil society, partnering with the private sector. Depending on the issue area, the constellation of partners will change. If we want to do something on cybersecurity, it's fairly obvious we will not be able to do it without the private sector. If we want to engage effectively in conflicts and crises, we will have to engage with civil society. So depending on the issue area, if you like, the configuration of actors will change, and we have to be more open-minded in the way in which we go about this and build this into our policy instruments and institutions. So partnership, responsibility, and engagement as the three principles of the global strategy. And then we move on to the core of the strategy, so the main priorities of the strategy. And we essentially outline five main priorities. These are priorities which are not defined in strictly geographic terms, but rather in more thematic terms. But it's fairly obvious that some of these priorities will be more applicable closer to home, others will be more applicable further afield. We begin at home. So the global strategy starts at home, and it starts with a European Union that has to be and has to become and strengthen itself as a value-based security community. There is a very strong sense, I would say, amongst quite a number of member states, which I think really reflects the perception and the feelings of European citizens, that somehow the European Union is the soft underbelly of European security. And that is obviously something that has to be rectified. What does this mean? Well, it means a number of things. It begins with defense, but it ends more broadly with security. On defense, basically, the argument that is going to be made is that the common security and defense policy, yes, it has to be a policy which is about providing security in the world, and more has to be done in terms of crisis response, in terms of capacity building. But CSDP should also be looked at as a policy for the protection of Europe itself. It has to be a policy which enables Europeans, European member states, to develop the capabilities that they need in order to protect themselves. It has to be a policy which induces capability development in a cooperative fashion. It has to be a policy which is underpinned by a strong and sound European defense and industrial technological base. So if you like, and all of this is necessary if the EU, and therefore if CSDP, is to actually act in a complementary fashion to NATO. So the argument is not being put forward, of course, that we should be replacing NATO. We are well aware that when it comes to collective defense, NATO remains the main framework for most EU member states. But we need to give complementarity real meaning. And to give complementarity real meaning means that CSDP itself has to really step up in terms of its own engagement and effectiveness. But then, of course, it's not only about defense. It's about security more broadly. And here is where we will go into issues such as greater cooperation and information sharing on counterterrorism, beefing up cybersecurity cooperation and capabilities, strategic communications, an issue which is particularly relevant to a number of member states, particularly in Central and Eastern Europe, external energy policy, something which is close to Norwegian hearts and minds as well, and external migration policy, which again is very much on the front lines and the front pages these days. So first priority, the EU as a security community. Moving out, the second priority is about the resilience of states and societies and surrounding regions. And by surrounding regions, we do not limit ourselves to the strict geography of the European neighborhood policy. We basically say that the geographic areas which are of interest and where resilience is a priority are much broader. anything that goes to the west of, let's say, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and anything that goes up north from the Democratic Republic of Congo, more or less. So it's a much broader geography than the ENP. But of course, we are aware that within this vast geography, there are different policies that are applicable. And it begins, of course, not even with the ENP, it begins with the accession process. It is clear that the resilience of Turkey, of the Western Balkans, is a strategic priority for the European Union. And therefore, what can be done in order to use the accession process, in order to, again, reacquire, if you like, its credibility in promoting the resilience of states and societies within the remit of enlargement. Likewise, in the European neighborhood policy, there are some countries that have an interest in moving closer to the European Union. It's not up for us to name who they are. At the moment, we know that Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova have a greater interest than, say, Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Belarus. But who knows? In future, that may change. It's not up for us to decide. What is up for us to figure out is what more are we willing to offer to countries that have an interest in moving forward, aware of the fact that what we will be able to offer more can contribute to the resilience of these states and societies. But then, of course, we have to admit that, and this echoes also what, for those of you that have seen it, is the underlying philosophy of the reviewed neighborhood policy, the new ENP. We have to admit that not all states want to move closer to the European Union. And that's just a hard fact of life. It is not what we assumed back in 2003. It's clearly the reality today. But it doesn't mean to say that the resilience of these states and societies is irrelevant for us. And therefore, we have to contribute to that resilience in a variety of ways. And it obviously has to be a tailor-made mix for each and every country. It's clear that the resilience of Tunisia will require a different mix than the resilience of Ukraine or Kazakhstan, for that matter. And so we have to work through the security, the governance, the economics, the societal, the climate, the energy, etc., policies, in order to define which is the accurate mix for each one of these countries. We will not be able in the strategy to go into the detail country by country. This will have to be follow-up work. But the overall concept will have to be outlined in the strategy. Moving on, third priority is about a more integrated approach to conflicts and crises. Now, state and societal resilience is all very well and good when the state still exists. But what do you do about the Syrias, the Libyas, the Somalias, the Sudans of this world? What do you do when the state has either imploded altogether or is so fragile that simply working at state level doesn't really allow you to get a grip over the entire country? Now, for these cases, we of course already have the so-called comprehensive approach to conflicts and crises. That is an approach that has to be implemented. For those of you that are not familiar, the comprehensive approach is basically the approach that says in conflicts and crises, yes, we have to use security and defense instruments, but we have to use them alongside development, trade, et cetera, instruments. So having a more, if you like, multidimensional approach to conflicts and crises. That is there. It has to be implemented. I think there is an opportunity to develop, particularly the security development nexus within the comprehensive approach, with steps forward which are already being made, such as the capacity building for security and development. So that is one aspect of it. But then what we're saying is we really need to stretch the meaning of that comprehensiveness. So we should be comprehensive in different ways as well. In what ways? We have to be comprehensive in the temporal sense, which essentially means we don't only have to intervene in crises when they erupt. We have to double up our efforts on conflict prevention. That tends to be an area where we're actually quite good at. It often doesn't make the headlines precisely because we're good at it. And often it doesn't need to make the headlines, because if it were to make the headlines, it probably wouldn't be a success at all. So we need to redouble efforts on conflict prevention, and we have to redouble efforts on post-conflict stabilization. So let's not forget the Afghanistans, et cetera. The way in which the refugee crisis is developing makes it quite obvious that we have to make a case for not abandoning crises when they exit, if you like, the political limelight. So a multi-temporal approach to conflicts. Thirdly, I think what I consider to be perhaps the most interesting or innovative aspect in this priority, which is really about a multi-level approach to these conflicts. Precisely because the state has at times imploded, simply acting to get Humpty Dumpty, putting Humpty Dumpty together again, at times doesn't really work. Doesn't mean that it shouldn't be done. Yes, it has to be done. But we see it these days, talking about Libya, for example. Yes, it's fantastic. We have a unity government, a transitional government, but it's already a miracle if it makes its way at some point into Tripoli. Even if and when it does, it will certainly not have the control of the entire territory. Which basically means that we have to act not only at that state level, but we have to act much more at the local level. What can we be doing more of in terms of strengthening local governance? You know, even in countries like Syria, in countries like Libya, governance actually does work and exist in pockets of the countries. What can we do in order to strengthen that governance? In countries like Libya or Syria, there are local ceasefires, which are often locally brokered. What can be done in order to secure and extend the reach of those ceasefires? So how do we rethink our policies when we actually take off or add on, perhaps, not only the state lens, but add on to it a local lens, add a regional lens, and a global one. So a multi-level approach to conflicts and crises. And then finally, in these conflicts, we have to act multilaterally on the ground, by linking up more effectively with other actors present on the ground, be it regional powers, be it bilateral donors, be it international organizations, but also, of course, at the global level and the regional level. We know that these conflicts and what makes them so complex, so protracted, is precisely the fact that it is the interlocking local, national, regional, and global dimensions which makes them so complicated and at times so toxic. So third priority, a more integrated approach to conflicts and crises. Moving on, regional cooperation as a fourth priority. And here we use the term regional cooperation fairly loosely. So it is not about, or it is not only about cooperating or strengthening cooperation with regional or sub-regional organizations. Yes, that's one dimension of it. But it's a lot more. It can mean bilateral relations. It can mean sub-regional relations, it can mean inter-regional relations, so we take a very loose, if you like, understanding. And we look at regional cooperative relationships in all four directions, to the north, the south, the east, and the west. When it comes to the north and the west, this is basically the positive side of the story. So it is basically a story about how to deepen and strengthen existing cooperative relationships. When it comes to the Arctic, what can the European Union be doing more to make sure that the Arctic remains an area for cooperation? Essentially on, and this is where the main European contribution is and can be, soft security issues, research, science, infrastructure, climate. When it comes to the West, what can be done in order to strengthen both the bilateral relationship with the US and Canada, but also the EU-NATO cooperation? Particularly post-Ukraine, and now in the course of the refugee crisis, it becomes fairly obvious that this is a relationship that has to strengthen and deepen. And let us see whether a resolution of the Cyprus conflict later this year will allow us to actually make that final jump forward. Obviously, when it comes to the East and the South, there is where the problems really lie. Taking the East first, we look obviously at the EU-Russia relationship. It is clear that the narrative, a bit like in Norway, I guess, is this is a relationship where firmness is of the essence. A fully cooperative relationship has to be premised upon the full respect for international law and the principles underpinning the European security order. So that's, if you like, a given. Having said that, partial engagement, practical engagement, transactional, however you want to call it, is possible not only in the way in which we're currently doing. We're already talking to Russia about when the Iranian negotiations on climate issues, on counterterrorism. Let's not unnecessarily compartmentalize. There could be European issues and not just global issues on which we may want to talk to and cooperate with Russia, be it on the Arctic, Russia being not only an eastern power but a northern power too, be it on infrastructure questions, on societal connections. There are a number of European issues where deeper cooperation and engagement are actually possible. Moving further to the east, there's China, and then, of course, there's the rest of Asia. When it comes to China, the main focus of attention is really the idea of China gearing up to becoming, if you like, a more Eurasian power. The Silk Road, the One Road, One Belt is all part of a general push, Chinese push westwards, which may be obviously slowed down as a consequence of the economic slowdown in China, but is of a we consider to be of a strategic nature. And it can obviously be something that can help boost European economies. But it's not something to be taken unconditionally. It is one of these issues where, firstly, unity is of the essence, European unity is of the essence. A bit like in the case of Russia, there is a Chinese tendency to divide and rule when it comes to Europe. It's a fairly easy thing to do, unfortunately. And therefore, your internal EU unity in dealing with China is fundamental. Likewise, it's important to make sure that whatever China does within Europe or within our shared, if you like, neighborhood, is done in a manner which respects the rule of law. So that's when it comes to China. When it comes more broadly to Asia, it is really going to be a story which is going to be principally about security. It's clear that the European Union is an economic actor. It's the main economic actor in Asia. And of course, Asia is fundamental for the European economy. But that economic interest, if you like, is really underpinned by security. And therefore, it's a false distinction to separate the economics from the security in Asia. One only needs to think about maritime security. It's quite clear that if we want to open and maintain trade routes when it comes to Asia, maritime security is of the essence. So what can we be doing more in order to contribute to Asian security, be it in terms of the respect for the rule of law, be it in terms of enhancing the capacities of particularly Southeast Asian countries in beefing up the maritime security capacities. Here is a potential role, if you like, for CSDP. South, obviously, there is the Middle East and North Africa, and there is Sub-Saharan Africa. Here, when it comes to Africa, one can say that the direction is fairly positive already. It's a question of reinforcing that positive direction in terms of cooperating and deepening cooperation with regional and sub-regional organizations. Regional, obviously, there's the African Union. Sub-regional, in the vast panorama of African sub-regional organizations, probably the two that stand out at this point in time are ECOWAS and IGAD. So we have a particular interest in the Horn of Africa and in West Africa. When it comes to the Middle East and North Africa, the situation is slightly different. Of course, there too, there are regional and sub-regional organizations, most of them fairly dysfunctional, one should say. It's clear that the EU has to deepen its dialogue and cooperation with some of these organizations. But the reality is that these organizations, unlike the case of sub-Saharan Africa, tend to replicate and therefore deepen existing divides in the region. What are the main divides in the region? They're well known. At the moment, obviously, the Iran Gulf division, the traditional Arab-Israeli division. Existing regional organizations simply replicate those divisions. So here, and it is not up to the European Union to create something new, let alone rigid institutional structures, but it really should be aiming at fostering the space for diplomacy and dialogue in a manner that cuts across some of these divides, be it in terms of capitalizing on its role in the E3+3 negotiations on Iran in order to create a broader Iran-Gulf engagement strategy, be it in terms of fostering functional cooperation on soft security issues in the broader Levant, perhaps dusting off the shelf The Madrid multilaterals, not calling them like this, obviously, given that they weren't a huge success, but in a sense, more successful than what ended up as, whoops, the Oslo process. So functional cooperation in the Levant. Another important aspect is obviously Turkey, and Turkey's double role as a candidate country and obviously a Middle Eastern power. And then fourthly, how to create and foster cooperative relationships and dialogue that link up sub-Saharan Africa to the MENA region, and in particular across the Sahelian belt, north-south, and then east-west, connecting the Horn of Africa to the Gulf. It's quite clear that there are a number of existing dynamics which are existing already, but which are not captured by existing relationships and organizations. Finally, I'm almost at the end, global governance. That's the fifth and final priority of the strategy. Essentially here, the story that is going to be told is different from the one of 2003. In 2003, effective multilateralism was about preserving the existing multilateral system. It's quite clear today that if we are committed to multilateralism, we cannot simply aim to preserve the system. I think the story of the AIIB is a harbinger for things to come unless we wake up. And waking up means a number of things. It means, first and foremost, reform. Reform of the UN system, reform of the IFIs. In what way can the EU contribute to that? Clearly, the EU will not be able to contribute to UNSC reform, but there are other aspects of of reform which the EU can actively contribute to. It is a question of implementing those agreements where they have been reached. And last year, we've obviously had two major successes, the climate deal in Paris, the SDGs, if one wants to add to that, the financing for development agreement in Addis. Now it's a question of implementing those agreements and doing so obviously by cooperating with like-minded countries and traditional donors. But I think collectively we have to reach out to the new donors. We have to think more creatively again about the way of involving the private sector, civil society in the realization of the SDGs. So it's about reforming, it's about implementing, it's about deepening global governance. And one needs to look at areas such as trade as areas in which global governance and deeper, if you like, global governance is built bottom up. Trade agreements, bilateral, plurilateral trade agreements, as agreements that can help foster global standards so long as they are pursued in an open way, and obviously they are then docked back into the WTO. Universalizing or widening global governance, arms control regimes, international justice organizations, what can we be doing more of in order to extend the remit of these regimes and organizations? And then finally, creating new forms of global governance in areas where those mechanisms simply don't exist at the moment, areas which lie on the frontiers of global affairs, cyber issues, energy issues, migration issues, issues which are going to become, which are global questions, and they are likely to rise up the agenda, but on which effective global governance mechanisms don't exist. So this is where, if you like, the priorities end. We will then, in the final part of the document, have to pull the threads when it comes to resources. What do we spend more on? What do we spend less on? What kind of choices are being made there? About institutions, in particular, how to improve the coherence and coordination, both across institutions, between the institutions and the member states. And thirdly, how do you change your ways of working, your methods of work? How to make, for instance, the European Union more flexible, more responsive? How can it build more on local knowledge? A lot of the priorities have obviously to do with having much more granular understanding of what happens on the ground, how to build that into the system. So this is where we are. We are, I think, content-wise, at a point in which the meat is beginning to be put onto the skeleton. But now we have to deliver this through, I'm not quite sure when at this point, but deliver this hopefully towards June, coming up this summer.
thank you very much. This was really great, and it sounds like the strategy is already almost completed, so it looks very promising. Now, Pernille, please.
Thank you, and dear Nathalie, thank you so much for an excellent introduction. We are very pleased to have you back here at NUPI. As you said, you came here 2 years ago, I think, to present, give another excellent presentation on neighborhood policy. And you're also involved in an ongoing research project here at NUPI. But right now we know, of course, that you are, it's difficult for you to do other things than working on this union's global strategy. And I'm also very confident that Mogherini has chosen the very best person for this job. And developing a global strategy for the EU is important, and it's also highly needed. As Nathalie mentioned, the world has changed radically since the first and the only strategy was presented 13 years ago, in 2003. In some sense, there is more need for a global strategy than ever before. And as you said, the EU needs some overall frame to go to guide the everyday decision-making or create some kind of common narrative, as you said. But at the same time, this frame is more difficult to set and determine in a period of multiple crises. If not resolved rapidly, these crises may very well change the very character of the EU as we know it today. And given this situation, it is extremely challenging to make a strategy that is both relevant and fitting for the EU and an environment that is changing. So good luck to you. most important, is it perhaps to get to some kind of new commitment among the member states that makes it clear both the benefits of having joint policies and also the risk of not having them. But in order to do this, it might be necessary also to reduce some of the aspirations and ambitions for the EU. By reducing the ambitions, it will increase the chances of actually succeeding, in many ways avoiding what has often been referred to in the literature on EU foreign policy, the expectations capability gap. Many of the challenges that the EU is facing are also Norway's challenges. So when the Norwegian government wished to go through the options for the future Norwegian foreign and security policy, it is important to follow the work that is done in the EU to be able to see how Norway could relate to these processes as an outsider. But in order to develop both Norwegian and European strategies, I think it is crucial to take note of some lessons from the past. And for the EU, I will highlight two lessons that I find particularly important, even though there are several, and Nathalie has referred to most of them here in her presentation. But the two that I will highlight here is first, how the EU has related to its neighbors. And secondly, what has happened to the EU as a global role model. First, there are lessons to be learned from the enlargement and the neighborhood policies. It is true that enlargement has been one of the most important tools for creating a stable and united Europe, at least until recently. But we also see that there is an inability to fully integrate all new members, and that this now threatens the unity and solidarity within the Union. There is now a clear east-west divide in the EU in addition to the traditional north-south divide. This means that there is time for some serious rethinking of these policies in order to find out what is needed to make it work, also after the candidate countries have joined the EU. With the neighborhood policy, there has also been mixed experiences. It has not worked as intended. It has not created the ring of prosperity and stability that was the intention when it was first launched in 2004. Instead, it has created something that some refer to as a ring of fire. In my mind, there are mainly two reasons for this. First, there is a gap in expectations, or there has been a gap in expectation between the partner countries and the EU, as well as a disagreement internally in the EU, concerning what should be the long-term aspirations for the partner countries, close association or membership. Second, the EU is faced with competing actors with conflicting interests in these regions, being it a major power like Russia or radical terrorist movements like Daesh or ISIS in the south. In a book that I have edited on this topic, I present a comparative study of the six partner countries, three in the south and three in the east, the so-called frontrunners. And the main finding in this book is that the ENP approach that has been modeled on the enlargement process, with focus on a technical Europeanization process, is to some extent a greater failure than the approach adopted towards the southern partners. And also here I will highlight two reasons for that. First, because there is less of a gap in expectation between North and the South. Membership, for instance, was never a real issue for these partners, even though Morocco applied for membership in the 1980s, but soon realized that that was not a possibility. And the focus has therefore also been between the EU and the Southern partners, been more focused on cooperation and reforms rather than integration. Second, there is no powerful competing actor in that region, like Russia in the East. So in spite of the many remaining challenges in the South, the countries in which we see the most positive development are still the countries that have rather extensive agreements with the EU, such as Morocco and Tunisia. While the opposite has been the case in the East, in Ukraine, for instance. The revised policy presented by the Commission in November on the neighborhood policy also showed that the EU is adopting a more flexible and differentiated policy. The objective is still on reforms, but the instruments are different and more tailor-made for each partner country. In many ways, the new ENP East is increasingly resembling the approach to the South, with focus on association and reforms rather than deep integration, at least for now. With the challenges of disintegration with Brexit and the East-West divide internally in the EU, it is possible that we will see the development of a multi-speed Europe. This means that there also will be different models for the EU to how the EU hook up to third countries. So depending on the context, the EU will most likely develop policies towards third countries that are based on policies on integration in a few cases, transformation in some cases, and finally different kinds of cooperation in most cases. The last category will be important and include cooperation and will include cooperation agreements also with different types of authoritarian regimes, like Russia, or to some extent Turkey, mainly for security policy reasons. The second lesson I want to emphasize concerns the EU's global role. The EU used to be a role model. This is no longer the case. Traditionally, the EU has been an important inspiration to other regional integration attempts, the African Union, the ASEAN, and integration efforts in Latin America. However, the many crises and decline of trust has now led to a serious loss of soft power and credibility. In general, it has become less convincing that regional integration can actually transform identities and reduce conflict. So what can the EU do to restore this? First, it has to keep holding on to its key ambition in terms of common policies without compromising on core values. But at the same time, and as Nathalie also mentioned, it also needs to find a better balance between interests and values. This means that it has to accept the need to sometimes cooperate with authoritarian regimes out of necessity, without an agenda of transforming them. Third, Europe must also protect the integrity of the EU and make sure that the EU has the necessary political will and the political means to act when needed. So how can this be done? Currently, it may seem that the only way to achieve this is by allowing a real and formalized multi-speed Europe to develop. And the Brexit referendum and the migration crisis may very well lead to such a development rather soon. A real multi-speed Europe may also facilitate progress in important areas such as common border control and common and fair asylum policy, common crisis response capacity, and even an efficient neighborhood policy. For Norway, and given this context, there are also two main lessons that I would like to highlight. First, lessons from our current relationship with the EU. EU's foreign policy shows that the EU and Norway has overlapping interests. And this explains why Norway traditionally has chosen to align itself also with most of EU external policy, and it has functioned quite well. Norway adopts most of EU declarations on foreign policy. It has been eager to participate in most policy areas, including security and defense. So while Denmark and UK and others have various opt-outs, Norway have instead chosen a model of opting in. It joins in on most of the EU sanctions, including the recent one on Russia. And even in areas where Norway is not formally participating, such as the neighborhood policy, we see that Norway chooses to follow the EU's approach. In a recent study that I've conducted with Josef Batora on EU's and Norway's engagement in Ukraine, we find that Norway is actively supporting Ukraine process towards EU standards in most of its projects. So Norway has in many ways been a constructive outsider. But faced with a Europe in crisis and an EU that is in search for new solutions, it is perhaps time for Norway to move from being mostly reactive to be more proactive in proposing solutions and offer contributions, be it resources or competence. Norway have experience in dialogue and conflict resolution. It has competence and experience with cooperating successfully with a challenging neighbor. It has resources, energy, and financial. And as part of Schengen, it should also be a more active partner when it comes to finding common solutions to mitigate the migration crisis. The second lesson is that in a new security context, the traditional tension between an Atlantic and a European orientation is less of an obstacle and should no longer prevent deeper cooperation between Norway and the EU. European defense cooperation is progressing more in cooperation and less in competition with NATO. French reintegration in NATO in 2009 has been important here, but also a general, more pragmatic approach from many countries, including the French approach. And the negative impact of the remaining technical obstacles between EU and NATO cooperation should not prevent further cooperation between Norway and the EU in this field. With more traditional security concern re-emerging, there is also more likely that it will be some kind of clearer division of labor between the two, with NATO focusing more on Article 5 territorial defense, and the EU more on this comprehensive approach for crisis management, even though, as Nathalie also mentioned, that the EU has to be more preoccupied also with defending the EU in defense issues. And a lower tension between the Atlantic and European cooperation should also facilitate stronger Nordic cooperation. So to conclude, given these lessons, both for the EU and for Norway-EU relations, I think it is high time for having an even tighter strategic partnership between Norway and the EU, a cooperation that moves beyond the technicalities of the EEA and Schengen and into a genuine strategic partnership. Such a partnership will, in my mind, be useful in order to actively search for common solutions to common challenges. While Norway has often been looked at as an odd outsider, a non-member that supports and wants to participate in most of the EU's policy without taking part in the decision-making, it is perhaps time for upgrading this relationship. If as a result of different crises in Europe, a multi-speed Europe is about to be formalized, Norway will perhaps not be alone in such a position in the future. And in the end, the EU might also be better off with more constructive outsiders or B members, than having them as potential spoilers within. Thank you.
You can share that microphone. Thank you so much, Pernille. Now we open the floor for discussion, and we open the floor, no door there, for some air. Thank you so much, the two of you. Do we have? Liv has a microphone. If somebody wants to jump in and say a few things, Bjørn Olav, please identify yourself.
Hello, my name is Bjørn Olav Knudsen from the Norwegian Defense Research Establishment. Thank you very much to both of you for a very good and interesting presentation. My question is, as far as I know, the Dutch EU presidency is at present working on a white book on defense. What they will call it in the end, I don't know, but they are working on it. You didn't mention that in your intervention. Can you please tell us a little bit about how these two processes goes? How do you coordinate these two things? Because this is the first white book on defense ever written since CSDP was initiated back in 2003. Thank you very much.
Please.
Yeah. So the non-white book. Okay, so basically the situation is as follows. The Dutch were very keen on this process happening during their presidency. The decision was taken that it would not have been wise for these two processes to happen at the same time. And that in fact the non-white book, or the defense strategy, whatever it's going to be called, should actually come as one of the spin-offs of the global strategy. So in an ideal world, the sequencing would go as follows. The global strategy comes out in June this year. It is welcomed by the European Council. And the European Council gives a mandate to follow up work, including on a defense strategy. For the white book to happen, one needs to have a mandate. At the moment, the mandate is not there. So in an ideal world, this would be, if you like, the crowning moment of the end of the Dutch presidency that launches the process on the white book. Having a global strategy comes the white book, which would deliver something by, I would say, the end of the year. Now, this is in an ideal world, meaning this is assuming that the UK referendum happens, that it goes well, and that there are no other hiccups along the way. But we're working, you know, one has to be optimistic. So we're working on that basis. So at the moment, I would say there are only a few first preparatory conversations. What we need to make sure is that in the global strategy, which will not be nitty-gritty detail, but there are all the sufficient hooks that we need in order to then move on to the work on the defense strategy, which therefore means that some of the preparatory work in a very informal way has already to, I mean, some of the conversations have to start already because we need to make sure we know what those hooks are. But formally, the work cannot begin until there is a mandate by the European Council.
Okay, well, I'll wait a few other questions and remarks. Could I just have one myself? You said a lot of very interesting things about the strategy, but there are two questions. The first is, kind of, since you obviously are very much in command of what happened in 2003, could I just ask you, what is the most surprising, or what would surprise us the most when we start reading the 2016 strategy compared to the other one? So, because it sounded like there are kind of small nuances, some changes, but it's not radical shift. So that's the first. What's the most surprising? And the other thing is a bit perhaps on what Pernille hinted to as well. When you develop a strategy, you can do that either from what you said. You say, okay, let's try to forge a common understanding. And also the other point is that let's try to advocate some kind of the benefits of acting jointly, not disjointly. But another approach is to say, okay, let's review, it's going to based upon experiences. What has been successful? What has failed? How to copy other strategies? So it's kind of more of a learning approach to the experiential learning. So how do you see that? Have you conducted reviews, or kind of how effective have sanctions been? Is that an instrument we should proceed with? How effective is this? So is it based upon kind of some, like, appeal to the scientist in you, not the kind of the politician starting, okay, what is the minimum we can agree upon?
What's really different? I would say what's really different is actually the underlying philosophy all of this. in a sense, 2003, as I said, was really premised on an understanding of a world which was moving in our direction, that we could shape and co-shape, almost determine, certainly when it came to countries in the neighborhood. That's not the approach of this document at all. If you like, what I consider to be the bumper sticker of the global strategy is that of pragmatic idealism. So what does pragmatic idealism mean? Let me begin with what it doesn't mean. What it doesn't mean is that you need to compromise on your ideals out of pragmatism. And this goes back to the interest values dichotomy, which is, in a sense, an old story. We may not have said it, but it's certainly what we did. Pragmatic idealism should mean something different. It should mean that you start with a snapshot of the world as it is, not as you would like to see it. And you try and pursue a policy which is based on your ideals, it's based on your values, but based on an understanding of what is actually going on. And I consider it to be a fundamentally different approach to 2003. So it's not realpolitik at all, but it is based on a world which is in many respects moving in a very different, if not opposite, direction from the way in which we would like it to work. But that shouldn't prevent us from engaging. And this goes back to then the notions of engagement and responsibility and partnership. It is at the same time based on an understanding that we will not be able to shape things on our own. On what's been the approach, I mean, I would say that this has been an exercise which has been mainly goal-driven. That's why we start with the interest and then we move on to the priorities. So we really try and focus on what is it that is essential to us in terms of goals. Yes, then we have conducted, in many respects, a sort of exercise on the instruments, what works, what doesn't. But that's implicit, if you like. Let me give the example of conflict prevention, which I raised. This is something that is going to be highlighted in the document. And one of the reasons why it is highlighted is precisely because we conducted that kind of exercise. And hey, it turned out that we did lots of really good things that perhaps were not well known. And that is something that works, that we have to invest more in. Because the good things that we did at times were kind of very small. You know, if more money, if more people, et cetera, were invested in it, we could have done a lot more. A slightly different shade, I would say, applies to sanctions. Yes, in some cases, they work. They tend to work when we actually engage quite deeply with local civil societies, because that can really help us discern when is it that we're really hitting who we're supposed to hit, when is it that we're actually ending up destroying the middle classes? When is it that, say, in the case of Syria, we end up actually supporting Daesh as a result of it? You know, perhaps jumping into sanctions just because you want to punish a regime is not necessarily the wise way forward. So, you know, all this is going to be implicit, mainly when we talk about the instruments rather than, but the starting point is what are the goals?
Please, over there, and then the question.
Hi. My name is Frode Bjerkås. I represent the Norwegian University of Life Sciences. I'm not a researcher as such. I work on communications for a larger European Union-funded project in community policing and post-conflict police reform. One of the researchers is actually working here at NUPI. So I was intrigued by your emphasis on conflict prevention versus, and this is a question, is that versus conflict or post-conflict stabilization? Where would you want to put your emphasis in the nitty-gritty details of that strategy? So that's the first question. Second question is, when you talk about multi-level intervention in various post-conflict or conflict-ridden states, is the multi-level ID a result of failures on concentrating on states? Therefore, we have to delve into smaller communities and to regional governance and to regional and local government actors. So will the emphasis going forward be more on local and the regional level rather than the state level? And I would also like Pernille to respond on these questions for the, because you're, I assume you're advising the Norwegian government on this, or at least you will give some input on this. So in the Norwegian strategy on post-conflict or conflict prevention and stabilization, where do you see the Norwegian policy going forward? And finally, a last comment to your previous answer. You said that the UK referendum will go well. What does that mean? Brexit or not?
Now we collect a few, if that's okay.
I also have two questions, if I may. I work here at the Institute. Thank you for excellent introduction. Maybe it's more like a comment question. I noted that on the first priority, the security defense question. And then you had on the third priority, regional cooperation, where the United States comes in. Now, the relationship with NATO and EU is, of course, that's all about United States. So I'm a little bit curious about how you kind of tackle that, because after all, that is the real security issue, the hard security issue, which is kind of come back these days, and it's really hinges up on a good relationship with the US. So if you could elaborate a little bit that. The second one is another topic that I've been working a lot on, which is the Western Balkans, i.e. enlargement. Maybe you could say a few words about what you think about that. The concern I have is, of course, that you probably heard this before, but it doesn't take much to derail the process. If you feel they lose prosperity, the big carrot of EU in the future, things derail very quickly in the region. So I'm concerned with that, and I just hope that that's really understood in this document being written. Thank you.
Thank you for a very interesting tour d'horizon of the work you are supposed to do. But my question is, we know what the diagnosis is, but you have also presented some ideas about how to deal with those issues. But we know that in the past, we haven't been very successful in addressing all those issues. My main area of research at NUPI has been for the last 20 years Russian foreign and security policy, and we know that when it comes to this relationship, the things did not work as we hoped them to do. So how, here we have also a set of issues that have to be addressed. For instance, we hoped very much that this question of economic and especially energy interdependence could act as a kind of facilitator of this cooperation. We have seen that although we have had very good economic cooperation, Russia was spending a lot of money on selling us gas, oil, and some other stuff. The political effect of this is below our expectations. So, how to make all those things work better than in the past?
Okay, so let me begin with conflicts. I would say that the emphasis is equally on conflict prevention and stabilization. They just belong, in a sense, to different places. I mean, in the section on conflicts, the main emphasis when we talk about a multi-temporal approach is going to be on prevention. We will mention stabilization there, but this really belongs then to the section on resilience. Because in a sense, if we are in a stabilization game, we're in a situation in which that state is kind of there. You know, the conflict in its most violent phases is over, and it's about building resilience of societies and states. So I would say that it belongs. So it's equal. They just belong to different places, if you like, in the document. On the multi-level aspect, and you know, is the focus on the local a consequence of the fact of failure at the national or state level? I would relate this back to the pragmatic idealism point. I think in many of these cases, Syria, Libya, Somalia, elsewhere, the truth of the matter is that we are not the ones that are going to be calling the shots. We are not going to be the ones that are going to determine what the future Syrian state is going to look like, or what the future Libyan state is going to look like. And this is where the pragmatism comes in. pragmatism or perhaps humility also, which is something which Europeans are not very good at. and I think that's part of the philosophy, the radical shift that we have to be really engaged in. But the idealism has to come in, meaning whether we're acting at that state level, at the local level, at the regional, we have to make sure that certain principles of governance, for example, are there and are embedded. We just have to sort of broaden our horizons a bit when acting at that at those different levels. So I wouldn't say that it's because we have failed at the state level that we have to act at the local. I think the starting premise is that we are not going to be the ones that are going to determine success or failure. We have to contribute, and we have to contribute at all of these levels. Brexit, it is very clear that the good solution, the good scenario is one in which the UK remains in the European Union. Let me say this very bluntly, I think it would be a catastrophe if the UK were to exit the European Union in ways in which we cannot even imagine at the moment. I know it's close, but we just, our working hypothesis has to be that. Otherwise, we may as well just give up.
When will you present this?
Well, this is a complicated question to which there is no definitive answer yet, because, of course, we were not expecting the date of the referendum to be on the same day as the European Council, which is a bit of an odd choice. but that's the way domestic politics works. So we'll have to wait and see whether the European Council has moved maybe a few days, not because of the strategy, but for more important reasons. But, you know, the mandate that the HRVP has is to present it by June 2016. I mean, I think no one is going to condemn her if because of this reason it's postponed a bit. But we will just have to wait and see in the coming weeks. On EU-NATO and EU-US, you know, in the section on regional cooperation, obviously there is going to be something on the US and something on NATO. But the truth of the matter is that particularly when it comes to these, I would call them structural partnerships. I mean, the term strategic partnership is kind of abused a bit. And we use it for countries which are either very strategic and not partners or the other way around. So we kind of, you know, slightly leave that one, one to the side. But it's very clear that, you know, there are a number of countries, actors, let's call them actors, because in the case of NATO, we're talking about actors, with whom we're going to be working with in a number of different policy areas. And the US and NATO, I would then add at the global level, the UN, for example, are three key examples, you know, at the bilateral level, the United States, at the regional level, NATO, at the global level, the United Nations. So when we're talking about resilience, when we're talking about conflicts, you're going to see the US, NATO being scattered all over the place. But then, yes, there is going to be a paragraph on them in the regional section. On the Western Balkans and enlargement in general, I mean, I think we have to, you know, there's a positive and a negative side of the story. I mean, the negative side is fairly obvious. This is a policy that has lost steam. Developments in many of these countries are going in the reverse direction. So none of this is good. The positive side of all of this is that I think there is a greater awareness today that this is really, whether it's the Western Balkans, whether it's Turkey, this is the strategic front yard of the European Union. So there's an appreciation of the strategic value of this region. Now, the problem is that an appreciation of that strategic value, unfortunately, in the case of Turkey, is even more obvious than the case of the Western Balkans, is being detached from the accession process. We have to reconnect those two. We have to make sure, and this is the argument that is going to be made in the global strategy, the point is the strategic value of these countries are not just because of where they are geographically, but it's the nature of these countries that will determine their strategic value. And therefore, the accession process has to be strict, it has to be fair, it has to be clear, it has to be reformed, priorities have to be comparable. We have to double our efforts in this regard, precisely because now we woke up to the fact that actually they're strategically important. Implementation, sorry, there was a final question. I mean, look, you know, I think that goes back to the capability expectations gap. You know, one shouldn't have too high or too low expectations out of this process. So it's clear that it's not that, you know, with the global strategy, finally, all problems about European foreign policy are going to be solved. No, that's not going to be the case. But neither is it true, hopefully, that nothing can be achieved at all. And there are some steps in terms of, you know, where can we be spending more? Can we change the ways in which we work on a number of different areas? Can we slightly rejig the way in which institutions work and work together? I think, you know, by looking at practical steps that can be made, it can actually move the process forward.
Pernille, do you want to say something? Because
just answer the question on conflict and the kind of the distinction between conflict prevention and the post-conflict stabilization. We just have a project, also EU-funded project on EU crisis response, and we haven't started this project yet, but we are about to start it. And our main aim there is, or argument in the application, is that you cannot distinguish between these. It's important to see, to look at the whole kind of crisis, the cycle of crisis, from conflict prevention to crisis response and to post-conflict stabilization, because this could easily change. You can have an operation, a post-stabilization operation, and then you could have a crisis erupt, and then you have to be ready to go in with a crisis response mechanisms again. So I think this is what we will focus on in that project. And if I'm to give advice to the Norwegian government or to the EU, I will say that it's very important to keep that together. And I guess that this is something that you're aware of also. Yeah.
Okay. And then here from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, you'd said that you didn't comment upon Pernille's remark on Norway's role. I think it would be interesting if you spend also a few minutes to think about that. You said the idea of strategic partnership is dead because, but listening to what you say on the bumper sticker, what you said is pragmatic partner would be a better coin than a structural pragmatism, please.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Katrine Bjerring. I work in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Section for Security Policy. Actually, I think Ulf took my first question. What's the implications for Norway? And I must say that you seem to be very modest in your way of thinking about the implementation of the strategy. I myself think that the work for Norway will really start when the strategy is there and we look into it and take your word for shaping a future, more ambitious maybe, partnership with Norway. So we look very much forward to it. Actually, my second question is, I've been following your tour around in Europe doing seminars like this and other activities. I assume you have been outside Europe as well. And it would be interesting to hear you say a few words about the reactions out there, in Russia, in the States, in Africa, and in Asia. Thank you.
Could we collect one more from Jonny Kalkvist as well? He's the deputy of the Norwegian Europe, the Europe Department.
Yeah, just simply following on to what my colleague broached on now. You talked about sort of the boomerang from the Democratic Republic of the Congo to Pakistan. And you also talked about a 360-degree view on everything, so to speak. It would simply be very interesting, I think, for a Norwegian, or at least partly Norwegian audience, to learn slightly more about what you plan to write about the High North. Not necessarily because of Norway, but we all know that the Russians take an increasing interest in that part of the world. So please share some of your comments on that as well. Thanks.
Please.
Norway. No. You know, as I said, you know, I think the term strategic partnership doesn't do justice to Norway. I mean, I wouldn't see Norway at the same level as Brazil or South Korea, for instance. So we're talking about something different here. And that's why, you know, I use the term structural to really highlight this. It is, yes, because we're like-minded, but it's beyond being like-minded. It's because we are close, because our interests are overlapping, because we act together in so many different places. When we highlight the notion of partnership, and we say it is about partnering inside and outside, and looking at the various issue areas and which is the constellation of partners that matters, Norway will probably fit in quite a few of those boxes. And so in a sense, you know, it is not a question of labeling a country X or Y. It is really about the practical, you know, where do we work together? How can we work more together? And I think in all of these areas that I highlighted, be it in the questions of resilience. Norway is extremely involved in Ukraine, in the east and in the south. And there it's a question of how do we partner and coordinate more effectively. Conflicts is obviously one of a traditional area of Norwegian foreign policy, particularly, I mean, the south obviously has been an area of huge focus for Norway over the years. And again, you know, on issues such as conflict prevention, where can we be doing more of together? When we talk about regional cooperation and regional relations, here I think, and you know, we were having, I think, a very interesting conversation over lunch about, in particular, Russia. What can we learn, European Union? What can we learn from Norway in terms of managing relationship with a complicated neighbor, but yet a neighbor like Russia? And then, of course, the Arctic. I mean, there, if you like, the starting position, and it echoes a bit what we say about East Asia. It is about making a practical contribution to cooperative relations and to security and to resilience and to development. So I don't think that the strategy is, I mean, firstly, we start from the observation that this is already a cooperative region. So it's not about a revolution. We're not in revolutionary mode when it comes to the Arctic. We're in trying to sort of catalyze further and incentivize a trend which is already a positive trend. And we don't want to do, so I think the first point to be made is we don't want to do anything to upset that. And that means probably that what we will be doing more of is going to be on the soft security side. That's why I highlighted things like infrastructure, research, you know, how to build the resilience of the Arctic, of Arctic states and peoples, and what can the European Union be doing more in that respect. I think this is going to be, this at the moment is the narrative. Don't expect three pages on the Arctic, huh? a paragraph. hang on, let me see whether there's on the outreach bit, and this highlights the structural nature of the partnership. I mean, actually, we haven't done very much non-EU. Within the European Union, we've basically done more or less 50 outreach events. I don't consider them only outreach events. I consider them consultation stroke outreach events. In the case of non-EU, in last November, I went to the United States, and we had very good meetings there, both closed door and sort of public meetings. A lot of very good advice, I would say, a lot of interest and a lot of very good advice, particularly given that they have a sort of long-standing interest, experience in drafting their own national security strategies. So it was very useful, particularly in terms of strategy-making processes, almost more than content, I would say. Last week I was in Japan, and there is a lot of interest, much more than what I expected, in the European Union, in particular this idea of the European Union playing a greater security role in East Asia. The HRVP will go to Addis in a few weeks, so there'll be an event there. Here, and I'll be, Brazil, Latin America, end of March, and New York in May. So basically, when we're talking non-EU, you know, these are the, what, five, six, I can't remember, events we're doing. So this really is to highlight that we consider Norway to be a very important country.
Thank you so much for dropping by. It's a great honor to be on the list. But just a footnote to what you say. I think that on this structured partnership, I think in the kind of, we never know what kind of world we're entering into, but this axis between the US, Europe, and Japan, probably going to be very important, I think. But the two points, if I may. First one on Norway, and they are tied together. So I think what you said today about the kind of how you see the strategy, partly where it's heading, I think it must be inspirational for the people writing the Norwegian white paper. Short, pointed. And also the content-wise of it, I think it's very fitting to the reasoning, I think, in the Norwegian MFA now. They can say whatever they want themselves. But I think, and then it's very, I think it's very interesting what you say in the sense that you open up and you talk warmly about the relationship with Norway. Lots of opportunities. Some of them will be lost, but there are still some. We have the energy security dimension. Big topic, but in order to be a partner, I think these people are so modest. I think it would be more comfortable if you had, because there are some costs of being a partner as well, but not sitting at the table. For instance, accepting sanctions but not participating in the sanctions committee is a bit of a political cost associated with that. But so. You talked warmly about multiple forms of cooperation, some kind of structured cooperation with NGOs and businesses, etc., for doing other things. So how do you see the possibilities of non-members in forming some kind of more structured partnership where there's some benefits, but also some obligations for non-members? So that's one thing, and that brings me over to the other topic that you concluded on, or you mentioned it briefly on. Your final part of the review, how to make this implemented. You said it will touch upon allocation of the budget, and then you say also perhaps make some institutional adjustments, partly to within how the EU itself, the institutional balance within the EU institutions, but you also hinted to a possible kind of allocation of kind of work between the EU and member states. Because I think somehow in order to be successful in the implementation, move towards well-functioning defense, industrial cooperation in so many areas, you have to engage in some kind of the member states in general, and particularly some of them more than before. So, to put it blunt, is Germany backing this strategy? And are they willing to go this way? Are France doing it? Is Italy doing that? Is Poland engaged and committed to it? So who are the ones who are really committed to it and will also change their investment policy, their research strategy, their kind of really commit themselves to this strategy? Because if it's just a strategy for the EU institutions, it's probably not going to fly.
Okay, so on the first question, this is a Nathalie answer. No? It's not a... I mean, but this really is a Nathalie answer. Now, here I would go back to the points Pernille was making. I mean, my sense is that if we're moving towards a European Union, I wouldn't call it multi-speed. I would call it more multi-level, because I think... Essentially, multi-speed gives the impression that sooner or later, everyone is going to get to the Holy Land. And maybe not. Maybe they choose different directions. Huh? And I think this is the EU that we're beginning to move towards. But I think, you know, this is not going to happen today or tomorrow. I think it's happening. But these are processes that will probably consolidate over the best part of the next decade or even longer. Now, if we do move towards, and we are moving towards, this type of different EU, then the kind of things that you're saying are going to be less heretic, you know, participating in decision making on issues, even if you're not formally part of the institutions. But, I mean, we're not there yet. And I think probably, we facts will precede us, meaning that we will end up having a multi-level EU, or then wake up to the fact that, hey, we have a multi-level EU, and then we're going to draw the consequences from it. But it probably will take still some time. On the question of institutions, member states, et cetera, I mean, this is not going to be two remarks. I mean, firstly, yes, indeed, it is an EU global strategy. It's not a European global strategy, which means that this is something under the authority of the HRVP. Yes, we need to have member state buy-in, otherwise it's irrelevant. And I would say that at the moment we have the buy-in, I would say, of all member states. There are some that are more at the forefront in terms of supporting this process. And indeed, Germany is one of them. France is one of them. The UK is actually one of them too. There has been a very strong support from the UK towards this process so far. Obviously, they would be cautious with a strategy that makes a very strong case for European defense. I mean, there are a number of things that one has to be careful with in terms of wording, but they've been very strong supporters of this process. And it's not obviously just the big member states. The Netherlands, now in the presidency, has been a very, very strong supporter of this process. But this is not going to be a strategy that is going to make a big call for a supranationalization of European foreign policy. No. It is, in a sense, a strategy which is about interpreting or reinterpreting what a common foreign policy means, meaning it's not a single foreign policy, but it's a choir. It's a choir that needs orchestration, but all voices provide value added, and we have to use them and use the different comparative advantages in a way which is synergetic. But it's not about eliminating member states. So in this respect, again, it goes back to the pragmatic idealism. You know, it is true that there has been a renationalization of European foreign policy. That's a fact of life. We can't pretend it's not happening. We just have to use it in a way which serves our purposes.
Excellent. One more question towards the back there, and then we should try to wrap up in 5 minutes' time or something. So I'll have this question, and then the two of you can have a final remark, please.
Thank you. My name is Chris. I'm from the University of Oslo. Regarding these CSDP, you had these EUBGs standing around, operational since 2007, I think, these battle groups. Are there plans to deploy them, or what's kind of the focus of the United Nations?
Please, then maybe you should. Maybe I will ask Pernille first to maybe if you want. Do you want to add something based upon what you heard?
Just, or very briefly, that I agree with Natalia saying that it's better to talk about the multi-level. I think because I agree with you that some countries might never kind of go the whole way, so it's more realistic. And also, perhaps strategic partnership is not the good wording for the. But I think it's important to have a focus on the aim of having a stronger partnership. With even though there is close cooperation between Norway and the EU, there are so much more potential there that are unused. So I think that put focus on that, and I think that is not only beneficial for Norway; it's also beneficial for the EU. I think I will stop there.
So final remark on the battle groups. Yes, what's the point of having them if you don't use them? One thing that I hope will be mentioned in the strategy is that this is actually something that could be used in the framework of the United Nations. It's clear that member state contributions to the UN have actually been going down and that the need is going up. It's a problem. And we have these battle groups. What are we going to do with them? Well, this is something that you could do with them. In what kind of circumstances could they be used? Who knows? If a truce in Syria ends up into a ceasefire in Syria, who's going to secure it? Turkey? Saudi Arabia? Maybe not. Is there going to be at some point a demand for Europeans? Is this something, I mean, you know, we're not going to be in a position to say exactly what should be happening, but highlighting the possibility of the kind of functions that the battle groups could actually be useful. Otherwise, there's no point having them. You're absolutely right.
Thank you so much. Let me just say one word towards the end. Thank you so much for taking your busy time to come here. I know that writing this and running, organizing, being engaged in writing a strategy, your phone calls all the time, your email box is really filled up. And so basically taking a break for a day, coming here, is really much appreciated. So thank you so much. When I listen to your presentation, I'm a bit becoming a bit optimistic. I think this strategy will be actually a completed document. It will be an interesting read as well. And thank you so much for being so open and to sharing your views, and also sharing, I think, is what seems to be a fairly ready-made kind of construction around the content of it, although the finer prints and details are not yet settled. I also think that it's one takeaway for me, at least, is that, and that's a bit optimistic, or it makes me optimistic, is that this will not be a strategy like some kind of Brussels jargon. It's not the newspeak. It's taking into account as the world as we see it, meeting some of the challenges at kind of straight forward, and trying to address them. And I think this is just extremely important these days. So that's really refreshing. And so it's a good evidence that kind of bringing in academics and clear thinkers into a process might refresh some otherwise bureaucratic things. So thank you so much. Good luck. Thank you so much for coming here.
Thank you. Thank you.